Hi, everyone. I'm Kaveri. I'm an illustrator, comic artist, and art director. So for the last 5 years, I've been doing... So for the last 5 years, I've been working in mostly with comics. I've been doing comics professionally for 3 years, and I've been getting money for comics for 1 year. So I'm going to start off with kind of talking about where I come from. I'm going to introduce you to only my comic work, not the illustration work. This is kind of an image of the point where I'm at work-wise. I trained as an animator years ago, and I had a more technical kind of approach with artwork. Somehow, I don't know, I was never able to be satisfied with communicating or explaining a story with just one image. So I guess in between from illustrating to animation is comics, so that's where I find myself at. So this is actually a comic I worked on when I was about 18 or 19. And I normally don't share much older work, but I thought I'd share something imperfect that I kind of worked on. And this is something I keep coming back to. So it's a story I wrote called The Day I Became a Boy. And I was a student that time at NID in the animation department, and I don't know, I was trying to figure out how to be an animator, I guess. And at that point in time, I always felt really underconfident about my story-making skills as such. Like, I didn't know whether the stories always thought of were very personal. I didn't know if they had any impact on society, or if they had any greater meaning apart from what I felt emotionally. But it was kind of interesting. So I basically, around this time, I lost my father. And I had like a lot of kind of anger in me, and I didn't know what to do with it. And I had a comic-making course around the same time. And there's a funny story that happened. So I had a teacher who kind of told me after this event happened that, this is unfortunate, but maybe this will make you a better storyteller. And of course, I was really offended. And I was like, this is, you know, insensitive. What does he mean? This is such a, you know. But oddly enough, I channeled a lot of like that rage, and this comic became very cathartic to me. So these are a few panels from it. It's a sort of a fantasy comic. I was very influenced by Kent Williams at the time, like a painterly style of making comics. I was also one of those design students who was always told that they should have just stuck to fine art. So the story is about a man who wakes up, and he suddenly realizes that he's middle-aged, and he kind of sees only emptiness around him, and he's lost everything. He looks out on the streets, and he sees like this carnival of life happening, and he wants to be no part of it. So he runs out through the crowd, and he runs backward through this carnival of life, and he goes back in time, and he kind of comes back to like a safe space, a place in his childhood. So to me, it was sort of giving someone a second chance, and this was probably the last time I remember, sorry, the first time I remember actually understanding why I would use comics as a medium, I guess. Why would I not make a film out of this? Why would I not make an illustration out of this? Comics just made sense to convey like things like, I don't know, like temperature or sound or smell. Anyway, so moving on. Yeah, so I continued with my whole illustration career and everything like that. But some years later, I was, yet again, I was like, oh, what is this life? You know, I'm not making much money and all that. So I applied for a design residency, an illustration residency, and I wanted to basically make a comic. I think that's why I joined the residency. I just wanted to publish, print something. And I made this comic called The Hungry Animal, which is about this... kind of a creature which lives inside this girl's stomach. So her, her organs are kind of like this forest it grows up in. This creature wants to climb out, and it has its eyes set on the prize, which is this fruit growing outside in another garden. Yeah, and the way I kind of work usually is I write like a bit of prose. I write a couple of words to me which have a lot of imagery. It becomes a sort of poem. And that poem becomes a comic. So I don't think you can read the words very clearly here, but basically I use the words as part of the text. And it's, I don't even know what the point of the story was finally. It's mostly about conveying like, I guess conveying trying to understand how I could convey, I think I was about 22 then, like how to convey, again, like things like temperature or lushness or, like when something feels very like warm and comfortable or when something feels dangerous. So yeah, this is an early experiment. And yeah, this is the most graphic design I've ever done in my life because I printed the whole thing on a large sheet of paper and I folded it. So I made a book. That was the last graphic design I ever did. From there, again, anyway, this is a story called Before You Step Out. It was published in the Hindu Business Link some years ago. And yet again, I was I'd been living in the city in Bangalore. I'm from Bangalore. So I was living there for maybe 3 years by then. And I used to always feel really unsafe on the roads. I used to always kind of resent the fact that, if it was after 7, I'd kind of visit only a certain grocery store, or if it was, I'd just restrict my movements a certain way. And so my family actually lives in a farm, and I'm used to having a lot of greenery, and I find a lot of solace in that. I kind of tucked myself away for 2 months, and I went and I stayed in a forest lodge kind of space. I was painting there and helping out. It was fun and all. And it made me really think, this is like a journal comic. So one evening I was walking on the down this path and there were no lights at all. And all I could hear was these rustlings in the jungle and the forest. And oddly I felt really, first I was really scared, I was afraid of the dark, but after some time I felt kind of comforted because I was trying to imagine me walking down a busy place like Indiranagar in Bangalore. And yeah, and thinking about how, made me think a lot about how like in the city, the one time where the only fear we kind of have is more from human activity or intervention, like in a forest or like a wildest space, you have to, an animal's not gonna come and like grab your bag or something. Yeah, so I think around this time is when I started thinking a lot more about public spaces. I knew definitely that one thing I felt very strongly about is that streets should be well-lit. Like the road has to be well-lit enough for me to see where I'm walking, what I'm doing, and who's around. That's just something that makes me feel more secure as like an adult living alone in the city. And this comic led to another piece of work which I did with, this was part of a residency with Zuban Books and the Goethe Institute. The book was called Drawing the Line. It was a response to the book. The idea behind the book was it was a collection of stories, and it was around the time of the prolific Delhi rape case, the Nirbhaya case, called by the media. So it was the theme, I guess you could say, was violence against women. And I was kind of stuck for ideas. I didn't want to make something fictional because it felt, it felt like I didn't know exactly what I could like tell someone or what I could inform someone to do about the choices in their life. I was still figuring it out myself. So I interviewed all the other women in the workshop, and basically my story is pretty much their story. It's called Basic Space, and this is a spread from it. So it was a series of about 5 small chapters. This is called Keeping the Line Straight. Keeping the Line Straight Every Day. So I asked 18 different women, all the women in the workshop were say between 20 to 60, I think. I asked them, what lines do you draw around yourself as a woman? Like I know, for example, when I'm in say using public transport, I keep my bag closed, I keep myself I physically kind of hold myself apart, and I want to maintain like a physical distance, which obviously is hard in Indian public transport. And the responses I got were interesting. I mean, right from one of my favorites was this one woman from Bombay was like, when I'm in the Bombay local train, I love it because I feel like a gunda. I just push people around, I kick them and all. And then I remember my mother told me that she always felt very safe traveling in Chennai in the buses because she and her friends would keep pins on their chains. And if anyone came close, they'd take their pin off and they'd give her a jab. And she felt very safe doing this. Like I'd probably feel more, stressed out about like traveling in a bus where everyone's groupie and stuff. This is a. Sorry. Oops. Right. This is another spread from the book. This was something a little lighter. I asked again. I kind of interviewed the same women in the workshop and asked them. Just imagine you didn't have to like draw these like invisible lines around you every day while traveling public spaces. Like, what would you do? What would an ideal scenario kind of be to you? And responses were everywhere from, I would not wear anything except a flower to accessorize. And someone else said that, I just want to walk out without dressing up like a mad woman. Because every time she'd got in pajamas, then her mother would be like, you look like a mad person. Like, please wear something normal. Run without hunching. Lie down in the gardens, in the Lodi gardens. And one of my personal favorites is over there, we're imagining a world without boundaries, which is just like spread, spread, spread. Like sit with your legs spread apart, sit any way you like. That's my sixth standard teacher. I hope she's well. Like their favorite word in school was corrupt. Like you are a corrupt girl because your legs are spread out. that was Neelima's, I think. Scratch in public anytime. Like if, you know, she's like, you know, I always see guys at bus stands or like chilling somewhere, just giving themselves a scratch. I really wish I could also, you know, I didn't want to go to the bathroom each time. Okay. This is a comic which I'm really fond of. Like every time I look at it, it just reminds me of my fond memories of my school days. It's called Apocalyptic Scenarios of Moral Decline. I worked on this with a Bangalore-based writer, Aarti, Parthasarathi. And I'm not sure if you guys remember, maybe 2-3 years ago, there was this newsletter which went viral. It was one of these newsletters or circulars in an Indian college, which had like a kind of like dress code or rules or whatever you're supposed to follow. And the rules were, obviously, God knows when it was from, it was pretty obscure. And stuff like, so basically these are the consequences. These are apocalyptic scenarios. These are the worst things that can possibly happen. Like a brass strap on the loose, the horror of bare visible arms. And this is actually a Christ College rule in Bangalore, that you can't wear leggings because they outline the shape of your legs. An absconding safety pin, that's from my school days. Like firstly we had full dupatta, full salwar, every inch covered. But your dupatta also had to occupy, you know, half your body at least, just to account for bra size, I guess. And bold online presence, because obviously WhatsApp and Facebook are where all the worst things happen. And finally, we come to the worst, which is talking to a boy. She's just fainted. She's teacher's like, I'm done here. This is the worst. So anyway, this is fun. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, Indian Express commissioned us, because rather than a statement piece on this circular that went viral, they were like, can you please make a comic? And it's another comic with my writer partner, Aarti. We started this online series called Urban Law some years ago. We used to always work on developing our comic libraries. We always want to keep buying these comics from different countries whenever we could get our hands on it. And one thing we kind of missed was like slice of life Indian comics, like everyday urban scenarios that we could kind of relate to and stuff, lighthearted stuff. And this is called Waiting for Auto. So anyone from Bangalore probably relate to the feeling, that heartbreaking feeling of auto after auto going past you and not one stopping. So here this guy is kind of trying to charm him, like, hey, how's it going, you know? Do you mind going to MG Road? This guy's just like, no. No thanks, bye, and he flies off. So we did a couple of these. I don't know what the social implications of it and all, but it was mostly just a humorous way of like looking at, you know, everyday urban life. That's it. Is this the right spread? Oh, the cover's missing. Okay, this is a comic called The Same Everywhere. It's sort of an autobiographical piece, not mine. I worked with a writer again, and this kind of came as a response to the recriminalization of homosexuality in India when the 377 was revoked. So around the same time, a friend of mine in Bangalore was feeling really, put off, disappointed, everything, you know, like why have they recriminalized homosexuality? Like, I feel unnatural, or I feel unaccepted. It's taken India so long to come to this point. And she remembered a conversation, I'm not sure if it was a few months after or before, with her best friend in Paris, who was, he worked as a translator in immigration office, and he was kind of having frustrations of his own. But this was around the time where I think there were major protests against gay marriages in Paris. So in the context of that story, we did this comic, which has two parallel stories. At the top, you can see some scenes from Paris. This guy is kind of dealing with his own stuff. And the bottom is this was like a pub scene in Bangalore where the LGBTQ community kind of got together and everyone was just raging and trying to find like a way to kind of deal with that anger and to take legal recourse, that sort of a thing. Here's some more pages from the same comic. This was part of an anthology called First Hand, which was graphic nonfiction from India. And it was a pitch that we both had applied for. So here this character in Paris, he's walking down the lanes and he sees these protests happening and he's growing kind of angry. And he just can't like take it anymore. He's also kind of flustered because same time his friend has been telling him about what were the protests in India about 377. And he climbed up, this was an actual incident, he climbed up the lamppost and he yelled out in French, "Stop interfering in other people's lives, you motherfuckers." And the protesters were like, "What the hell, who's this guy?" And this brown guy is hanging onto a lamppost. So he went running, basically, that's where the story ends. This was maybe about a year ago. I was invited to be part of a residency called from a magazine called Spring Magazine in Germany. And they had a residency in India, which was for Indian comic artists and German comic artists. So the comic which I worked on was called My Secret Crop. That beautiful bit of design over there is to show that I wrote a poem first and based the comic on that. Because I had absolutely no idea what comic to make in. You know, by this time also, I always felt like, okay, I'm making these comics on women, you know, women, women, women. Do I have any authority? What do I know? I know nothing. My Secret Crop is, this is like the rough sketches of it. It's a story about secrets. It's a story about kind of growing up, and it's this girl who finds like her first body hair, and she's really fascinated by it. This is what happened to me when I was younger. You know, you're like, wow, what is this? You know, no one ever told me this was part of growing up also. And the character in the story starts seeing hair everywhere. So she's in a car. These are process sketches. This is how I work. So these are pencils, one light color, just because. And yeah, like some basic color over it. So anyways, it's just this idea of adoration. So she looks at her body hair as this kind of a secret crop that she's building and no one else knows about it. Yeah, all right. Okay, resistance. Last summer, a magazine in New York called Fader Mag wanted to do an edition which had, the theme was resistance, and they wanted to ask 5 comic artists around the world to, the brief was just, your theme is resistance. And you guys come from, I don't know, like South Asian countries, so have fun. this was, I mean, actually my submission was a phone photograph. I didn't scan, I was that lazy. So it looks a little blurred right now. It was that small in print. resistance, you know, Mitro, Chitro, like the when the standing up for the national anthem became mandatory. I guess it was kind of mandatory earlier, but I don't know, seeing that 3D, you know, not even like a nice video, like a 3D flag in the theater and, you know, standing up and feeling really stressed out in case like I had food in my hand or, you know, I want to sit down. I just want to make an angry comic. So resistance is just these two characters who are jumping up and screaming. And I don't know, some claws of patriotism are coming from the flames. And I don't know, the father of the country speaks and stuff. So this is a lot of fun to work on. Anyways, we're coming kind of closer to the end, but about 2 years ago, I was given the opportunity to work on my first graphic novel. This is Two. It's a graphic novel that opens from two sides, published by Scholastic. So the side I worked on was this one, the right side up one. Yeah, two is it's a coming of age story. It's a young adult story about the side I worked on was a young girl from Sweden. She finds out about India. She's excited about India, and she's a little bit spoiled. She convinces her parents that she wants to go there alone, and she's about 16. And the story is basically about how she, it's about when she comes to India. It's not so much about culture shock and the usual stuff like that, but it's how she kind of, she grows up and also comes to terms, of her own sexuality in a way. And there's a bit of myth and stuff in it. I don't know, it's a little complicated. I drew a lot for this book. Like, that's what I wanted to highlight. I really enjoyed it. I didn't have much Photoshop. I work mostly with a brush pen. So I just had like my paper and my brush pen. I drew obsessively for about a year, which was great. So here are some sketches from the behind the scenes of the book, I guess you could say. These scenes where she's trying to escape these young drunk fellows in the beach, and she runs into the water, and she has this fear of drowning in the water. So for, at least from like an artistic perspective, it was like more like challenging myself. And I drew a lot of dolphins. I drew many, many, many dolphins. I had to learn how to draw a dolphin, kind of. It was creative license, fortunately. These dolphins had to emote, because the two characters who meet in this book, they drown underwater and they re-emerge as dolphins. I know. So I drew lots and lots of dolphins. And here are a couple of like low-reds panels, pages from the book. It's colored digitally. I had a lot of free rein with this, actually. I think that's why I enjoyed like the work process so much. I could just kind of do anything. And the scene over here at the bottom is when this boy kind of asks her if she wants to have a beer, and she's come alone to India. And it's the next page is kind of that feeling of being like, I don't know, like shame and anger and being trapped. Like, it's just a hand on her shoulder, but she has like this sense that something really bad is going to happen, and everything like closes in. And the scene above is where she tries to rescue this boy, and he, which is like an impulse when you're drowning, he grabs hold of her, and they both kind of sink to the bottom of the ocean, but they're reborn as dolphins. Okay, we're actually coming to an end now. So this is just a dream comic. It's called My Dream Trump's Yours. It's before Trump won the elections. I don't know why. I think I started reading the news suddenly, so I had a whole dream about Trump. It was horrible. And in my dream, I was this, basically I was working for an NGO, and Trump gave us a lot of money. He just kept throwing it. And I don't know why we were sad, but we were just sad, and because we found out he was funding us. But of course, you're just happy to get money and funding. And then this figure kind of, one day when I was working apparently very hard, there's this huge figure comes from behind, and he's like, shh, come here. And Trump is like, I know I gave you some money. You think you can give it back? And this is like a memory from my first job, because I'm like, it's my transport allowance, it's what you give me to get my cab every day. And he's like, no, I have a lot of respect for your country and its chaiwalas, but it's just that, no one else is spending as much as you. Why do you live 20 kilometers away from work? And anyway, so he goes on cribbing, and I'm like sadly saying Bangalore traffic, I live far away. And I don't know, maybe it's my own frustrations or other things. He's like, we can't change the rules just for one person. And then he has a solution. Because he's like, I got it. And this is how the dream ended. I'm sorry, I don't have a better ending. But he said, my mother gave me the money, actually. So it's her money. So can you give me back the money? No one will know. It's okay. That's it. Yeah, I'm kind of done. I'm leaving you guys with a favorite image from a book I worked on. That's it, like a quiet scene. The dolphins are very happy. Thank you.